Namaste to all. Manogna and I would like to begin this talk by thanking the team at Sangam Talk who made this session possible. Thank you very, very much. Before we proceed further, two things. Our work, papers, presentation and more are accessible from our account on Academia. It's called Bharatiya Chronology. You see the link at the bottom, where even this presentation too may be uploaded later. Now, for reasons both academic and otherwise, we request that screenshots taken, if any, during the session are shared along with the link to the presentation in Academia so that there is traceability. Thank you. Now, also, neither of us associates wholly with either left wing or right wing or any wing or any ideology, and it would be rather reductionist and news to us if our views or our work can be reduced wholesale and stuffed into such claustrophobic labels. Now, with those two things out of the way, the title of our talk today, as you can perhaps see, is From the ABC of Indian Chronology, Epoch of Buddha's Parinirvāṇa. Now, on your right, you will see what we call the ABC of Indian Chronology. It's a framework that Manogna and I introduced in our first paper on chronology, jointly authored in 2016 and presented in early 2017. ABC here, as you can see, is an acronym. A stands for Aryan Migration, B for Buddha, Gautama and Bharata, as in Mahabharata, and C for Chandragupta Maurya. Now, our talk is divided broadly into three parts. In the first part, after brief introductions, which will include a bit about our backgrounds, a timeline of our joint work on chronology thus far, we address three whys. Why chronology? Why ABC of Indian Chronology? And why the Heinz Bechert's volume? Which, as you may have noticed, is mentioned as part of what differentiates our work from some of the other works on the epoch of Gautama Buddha, especially after 1995. In the second part, we present some facets of our original published multidisciplinary analysis, the disciplines being philology, archaeology, astronomy. And in the third part, after stating our conclusions, we look forward to taking questions, if any, that are specific to our presentation, for which we seek the support of the session moderator from Team Sangam. Okay, so a bit about our background now. Manogna Shastri is a Swadeshi Indology research scholar and published author. She's a Master of Science from the Indian Institute of Astrophysics with a strong background in theoretical physics and mathematics. Her research interests encompass consciousness studies and civilizational studies centered around India, including focused aspects of chronology and desacralization. Manogna is a passionate environmentalist involved with solid waste management issues in Bengaluru, as well as a keen gardener. Her papers can be accessed on Academia at her link, which is shown at the bottom. Over to you, Manogna.
Namaste to all of you. It's a pleasure to introduce my co-author, Megh. Megh Kalyanasundaram is an Indian citizen with close to 9 years of professional experience in China. His postgraduate specialization in strategy, marketing, and leadership from ISB included a study of research methods. His professional experience includes a stint as market leader at a Fortune 40 technology firm and a term on the board of a Shanghai-based not-for-profit. His research interests currently include Eurocentrism, decolonization, ancient India in global and transnational history narratives, with a focus on aspects of chronology, Indian knowledge systems, landscape and texts, philosophy and jurisprudence. Other professional and pro bono pursuits have included building differentiated digital platforms targeted at specific learning and research needs, and composing new songs in Sanskrit. His contribution to an aspect of the International Day of Yoga was recognized by an invitation to attend the inaugural at the UN. His papers are accessible at his Academia profile, which has been shown. To give a sense of our collaborative work, Megh and my collaborative efforts started on chronology from our first participation in 2016 at the first Swadeshi Indology conference held at IIT Chennai. At the second SI conference held at IGNC in February 2017, we presented our first joint paper, Purvapaksha of Sheldon Pollard's Use of Chronology, in which we introduced for the first time our ABC framework. This confederation was based on our analysis of chronological positions of 17 important voices across extensive periods and backed by resulting comparative read-in tables of chronology. The paper also introduced some of our original philological data and analysis on the river Saraswati in Mahabharata. All these efforts were recognized with a Best Paper Award at the conference. In late 2017, at the third Swadeshi Indology Conference, we presented our work on the A of the ABC of Indian Chronology, which examined certain dimensions of the Aryan problem. Throughout the year, we also continuously engaged with ICHR and the Ministry of Electronics and IT through the mechanisms of RTI and public grievance redressal to effectuate certain important changes to the National Portal of India website. In 2018, our work on dating Gautama Buddha's Parinirvāṇa, a critique of Heinz Bechert's Echo Chamber, was published in the Quarterly Journal of the Method Society. In 2019, our paper on the Aryan problem from the perspective of textual evidence and linguistics was presented at the 6th Swadeshi Indology Conference at Delhi University. Further, the B of ABC of Indian Chronology was presented at the inaugural conference on Indic Chronology at IGNCA, and our work on the Saraswati in the Mahabharata was presented at the International Conference on Indic Chronology at Punjab University. The paper was appreciated by Padma Shri Dr. Subhash Rath as well, to which both of us are grateful. In March 2020, our abstract of the paper, Re-examining Indology, the Place of a Reliable Bharatiya Chronology, was shortlisted by IIAS and ICCR for their International Conference on Re-examining Indology, Retrospect and Prospect. That is the timeline of our joint work thus far, and Megh will lead us through more specifics.
Thank you, Manogna. So, taking off from where Manogna closed the timeline with, our abstract, which was shortlisted for IIAS ICCR International Conference last year, that abstract, which you see on your screen right now, is a good segue into some of our thoughts on why chronology. Also, given it contains some related questions, of which I will mention just one here. For sustenance of a reasoned, empirically verifiable narrative of Bharata's past and a fair global history of ideas and vidyas, should a reliable Bharatiya chronology matter? To be clear, it is not our view that chronology is the only facet of the study of the past. It is not even our view that it is perhaps the most important facet of a study of the past, or that every scholar working on history has to study chronology. Of course, all studies concerning the past need not obsess over chronology, dates, etc., etc. And we readily agree with some other scholars who emphasize the need to look back into the past for topics such as ethics, values, etc. At the same time, however, while everyone studying the past need not focus on chronology, surely it can't be the case, or at least a reasonable case from our point of view, that chronology is wholly ignored by all scholars dealing with history, simply because of challenges in pursuing it, which could be because of, for instance, destruction of evidence, either natural or forced, perceived gaps, etc. Chronology, in our view, has its commensurate place in the study of past, including in early India when indigenous concepts such as Vamshavali existed, for instance. Now, scholars like Sheldon Pollock, for instance, place chronology at the heart of the comparative historical process, quite rightly so. To recognize that is not to endorse the need for comparative historical practice, but to simply say the fact about its place in the comparative historical processes. Now, without chronology, establishing cause and effect can be difficult, if at all possible. Altered chronologies can also allow for the possibility of proposing new hypotheses, which could constitute serious issues such as appropriations, reattributions, distortions, leading to inventions of new ethic histories altogether, or problematic wholesale characterizations of an entire people, a civilization, and their texts by calling them things like lack of historical consciousness. Now, Manogna will now address the second why, which is why specifically ABC of Indian chronology. Over to you, Manogna.
This understanding may expanded on of the central role of chronology in historical causation on one hand, and as a vital part of the ethic lens on the other, is important while considering any chronological template. In particular, the results of historical practice applied to the Indian past are manifest in their most potent form in the ABC framework, as we will see in this section. Almost all mainstream academic material, for instance, consider this 2019 edition by Murphy and Stapleton, titled A History of Asia, carry a chronological template for India, such as that shown in this timeline, with milestones centered around key points: the alleged Aryan migration in 2nd millennium BC, Buddha dated approximately around 5th century BC, and Maurya around 3rd century BC. Changes to any of these key milestones, based on critical examination of the assumptions and methods which led to these dates, has a domino effect on the entire chronological template of India, as well as the results of commonly accepted historical practice. For instance, if Aryan migration is disproved, then it could lead to potential restoration about the truth of the indigeneity of civilizational assets, such as the earliest form of Sanskritam, amongst other consequences. If Buddha and or Chandragupta Maurya, which is the sheet anchor of Indian chronology, is changed, then it has a cascading effect on other aspects, such as, for instance, dating the Upanishads. The milestones thus chosen, Aryan, Buddha Gautama, Bharata, and Chandragupta, form the nodal parts of our framework for Bharatiya chronology. Understanding the implications and stakes of this disproportionate impact has been central to our work in chronology. On the Aryan problem, our 2017 paper recognized that whether posited as an invasion by or migration of Aryans, the variant forms of this into India hypothesis are underpinned by one constant, which is the consequence that priceless civilizational assets, such as the earliest forms of Vedic culture and Sanskritam, are not indigenous to India. Given this rather startling consequence to Indic history, our paper meticulously demonstrated an absence of proof for such a result in key Indic texts through a study of the terms Arya and Dravida by creating more than 200 data points from a range of Indic texts. We also considered the specific problematics in the development of the Aryan hypothesis in historical linguistics, including new and original arguments. Further, in 2017, we saw the importance of leveraging our academic research to effect changes on platforms such as the National Portal of India, which until our efforts carried questionable statements related to our historical collective identity. Through RTI and other mechanisms, we engaged with the National Portal of India, raising 8 documented and pointed questions concerning the representation of Sanskritam and the Aryan issue on their website. Subsequent to our questions and engagement, the words Aryan and Indo-European were edited out of the National Portal of India, along with problematic statements concerning the origin of Hinduism and composition of the Rig Veda taken down. This marked for us an important token of the impact of our work. Another key milestone of Bharatiya chronology is the epoch of the Bharata War. And as a part of our ongoing work, Megh and I have created a database of 222 verses of the utterance of the term Saraswati from the 80,000 plus verses of the Bodhi critical edition of the Mahabharata. we have identified in this database how many and which of these terms specifically refer to the river, and studied the verses for descriptions of its vitality. In light of scientific evidence from fields including geology, geomorphology, geohydrology, archaeology, and textual evidences, we explored the possibility of a terminus antiquum for Mahabharata at around 1900 BC. Amongst all mainstream chronological accounts, the dating of Chandragupta Maurya, referred to by the C in our ABC framework, refers to the first quarter of the 4th century BC, finds a conspicuous consonance. This sheet hanger of Indian chronology, based on the synchronism between Chandragupta Maurya and Sandrakutus of Greece, is subject to a close scrutiny in our paper to understand the agency behind this now 220-plus-year-old conjecture. We trace the genesis of this idea by explicating the main threads of work of several players, from early European Orientalists such as Jones, Francis Wilford, Mill, Princep, Elphinstone, Mueller, to Weber and Mapleduff and Vincent Smith, as well as modern Orientalists such as Rhonda, Pollock, and their Indian sepoy counterparts such as Thapar. The consequent theorizations and distortions that have emerged in the mainstream narrative from this important milestone are studied in our 2017 paper. Considering the key chronological milestones discussed thus far, our ABC framework broadly classifies the positions taken by scholars on them as insider or outsider. The ABC framework thus becomes a short yet effective checklist of four Indian chronology-related poison pills, which, in our opinion, present divergent positions from the chronological narrative that existed prior to the colonization of India. A scholar might be, based on the approach used for one epoch, be an insider, whereas on another epoch, based on the approach used for it, be an outsider. While each milestone has specific arguments on what constitutes an insider or an outsider position, we draw attention to some characteristic traits of both. Demanding higher standards of multidisciplinary critical examination for data from Indic sources, when compared to those from other traditions, particularly Greek, is a quintessential outsider approach. This is sharply manifested in the default suspicion and lack of critical examination with which data from Indic sources is treated, and in fact accepted only if corroborated by a non-Indic source. While differences in ethic and emic perspectives are expected in the study of any civilizational progress, the extent and depth of distortions of Bharatiya chronology that have resulted from the foisting of the outsider approach as the mainstream present a strong enough case for it being one of the biggest victims of Eurocentrism and Western universalism. The insider approach, on the other hand, while using critical methods, does not resort to excessive hermeneutics of suspicion in its treatment of Indic sources. The use of methods and sources from within Indic canons and traditional disciplines to corroborate timelines is given primacy. The treatment given to oral tradition is another point of divergence between the two approaches, with the outsider position devaluing it. On the Aryan issue, the outsider position subscribes to the Aryan migration into Bharata theory, and as discussed earlier, attributes Sanskritam and the Vedas to migrators rather than indigenous conceptions. The insider position questions the migration theory as well as the key non-attribution of Sanskritam and Vedas to the indigenous people. On dating Buddha's epoch, the outsider position pegs it to 6th century BCE or later, while the insider approach questions this, especially considering that it is based on the Chandragupta Maurya synchronism and Sandrakutus synchronism. The outsider view's primacy, accorded to the synchronism as a sheet anchor, is challenged in the insider approach, and alternate possibilities, which also fit with Indic sources are studied. The ABC framework thus has its chassis made out of these four tremendously consequential chronological milestones, with insider and outsider positions on each subject to specific conceptions. Megh will now take us through why we chose to engage with the Heinz Bechert volume in particular, concerning the B of the ABC framework.
So having seen why chronology and why ABC of Indian chronology, now on to the third why. Why Heinz Bechert's volume? In our view, we see at least three reasons. It is by far the most voluminous multidisciplinary publication dealing with the epoch of Buddha, making it perhaps unarguably the gold standard in mainstream academia for this topic. It is hence less surprising to see it cited in reference textbooks for history students in India, for example, the one by Dr. Upinder Singh, and in reference links on the Harvard domain. Now, recently, Bechert's volume, I'd shown this earlier, but waving it again, has been hailed as a tectonic shift in what Dr. Dominic Kujastik, an influential scholar, has called revolutions in Indology. Now, one way to grasp the significance of Buddha's epoch to the mainstream of chronology of early India, in mainstream academia that is to consider the words of Bechert himself. Quote, "Most chronological calculations concerning the age of Brahminic literary works on the development of early, middle Indic languages, etc., are based on this date, because both Westerner and South Asian researchers made all relevant calculations using this chronology as a starting point. The same may be said for many datings of archaeological findings in the pre-Mauryan period," unquote. Now, Christian Violetti's chart, originally found in ancient.edu and now also in open.edu, can help one visualize the different named schools of thought in play, in the academic mainstream at least, when it comes to the date of Buddha. They are, as you can see on your screen, long chronology or Ceylonese, corrected long chronology, short chronology, which is ironically called Indian. We will come to all of this in a bit. As a summary of Bechert's view, as we understood it, in the course of his final analysis, Bechert has endorsed the original correction to the long chronology, hence rejecting the long chronology, has then gone on to reject the corrected long chronology also, and the subsequent short chronology in favor of his view. He has placed the Nirvana between circa 400 BC and 350 BCE. Now, while this is kind of short summary, let's dive deeper into some aspects of this volume. But before doing that, though, some historical context would be very relevant. In perhaps the first book in English, at least, focused solely on Indian chronology, titled The Chronology of India, and published towards the end of 19th century, its author Mabel Duff included the following remarks on how the date of Buddha's death was assigned. Quote, "The chronology of this dynasty and that of Buddha's date are determined by the initial date assigned to this king," unquote. This king, as you can see, referred to Chandragupta Maurya. Duff makes it also clear who should be credited for this. Quote, "To Sir William Jones, we owe the identification of the Sandrocotes or Sandrocoptes of the Greek writers with Chandragupta, the founder of the Maurya dynasty, whose date BC 315, unquote. About a century before Duff's book was published, William Jones, writing towards the end of 18th century, had posited that Chandragupta was, quote, no other than the very Sandrocotes. It should be remembered that Jones was writing a little over a century after James Usher's now perhaps infamous, but then famous hypothesis of the creation of the earth in 4004 BC. In fact, Charles Petzold has recently traced the change of biblical chronology in Encyclopedia Britannica And I'll just cite one excerpt from his work. Quote, in its History of Encyclopedia Britannica, the great E.B. notes that the 10 volumes of the second edition published between 1777 and 1784 include many new articles, including the one that we are interested in. In chronology, the date of the world's creation, based on Archbishop Usher's reckoning, first added to the English Bible in 1701, was given with firm decisiveness as 4004 BC, unquote. It should hence be less surprising now to see a colonial Jones attempt to force fit the then chronology of India into the Usher biblical frame. Hence, you have the chronological table you see on the right of your screen right now, where Manu is placed along with Adam and Rama is added to the table much later. Now, while there are many people and many voices, some may say scholars, between Jones and Duff, who took Jones's synchronism to be some kind of a sacrosanct thing and proceeded to make changes to Indian chronology, there is at least one European published evidence from the 19th century that records, quote, Google translation, that Chandragupta, according to Hindus, lived 1502 years before the Christian era, unquote. This is found attested in M.A. Troyer's French translation of Kalhana's Rajatarangini, published in the middle of 19th century. Troyer seems to have called out what might today be characterized loosely as Eurocentrism when he wrote, and I quote Google translation, "We must above all leave aside the opinions of European writers today," unquote. Now, coming to the Bechert's volume proper, and in it, Dr. Sigmund Dietz's essay. According to Bechert, Dietz's essay is a detailed presentation from, quote, the earliest period of relevant European publications, unquote. Keep this in mind, this is European publications. There is a gap over here before European publications, and outside of Indic publications, you have some Islamic sources, and Vedvir Aryaji recently has brought out some good findings in this regard, and we'd like to acknowledge that. In part one of that essay, we found in Dietz's essay, we found at least 27 different names, starting from Matthew Ricci, 1584, to Jonathan Forbes, 1836. These have been tabulated with more detail in table 8 of our paper, but the 27 names have been included in this slide for your reference. Let me draw your attention particularly to Eugene Burnoff, who, writing about 30 years after Jones had postulated his synchronism, had given an explanation to reconcile a Japanese source with the Sinhalese-based epoch. And I quote, "This, though, is not the true date of Buddha's Nirvana, 543 BC, being the date of the death of the patriarch who first introduced the Buddhist teaching to the Sinhalese, whereas 950 BCE is the true date of the Nirvana of the Buddha Shakyamuni," unquote. This is just one example of how there were attempts to reconcile earlier epochs, the ones other than the Sinhalese-Ceylonese one, which was fast being favored Orientalists. Now, after identifying the 27 names, what we did was, through constructing of stemmas and a genealogical trace, we identified the following groupings on positions, which have been tabulated as you see on your screen. Now, the broad groups that emerge are Siamese, Sinhalese, both scholars who endorse these positions in one group. There's a Christian view. There's a view that Jesus Christ and Buddha are the same also, for good measure. Then there are Chinese views, there are Tibetan views, and what you see is an basically assorted positions. Now, at this juncture, four observations, in our view, merit emphasis, that there were, from this table, as you can see, many different views about Buddha's Parinirvāṇa, and 542-543 BC was only one of the many. Okay. The second thing is, in this part one of her essay, the Brahmanic or the Puranic data point of middle second millennium BC, recall Troyer's attestation, is actually completely absent. Absent is also any dated primary source indigenous to the Indic tradition, text or inscription, that actually supports 542 or 543 BCE. And there were others, we gave you one example of Eugene, who were theorizing alternate reconciliations other than just endorsing 542 or 543 BC. In other words, we first see a selection bias evident from the so-called Brahminical data point being ignored, which was upheld even by 19th century scholars like Troyer, who was no Brahmin, by the way. Then a hasty generalization, as should be evident from questionable prioritization of 542 BC as the year of Buddha's Parinirvana, followed by a confirmation bias as evidenced by the arbitrary correction to 542 BC in order to ensure consistency with the Chandragupta's Andrakotas synchronism before rejecting the corrected long chronology itself finally on other grounds whilst retaining the synchronism effect. Now, the Ashokan edicts were assigned the dates based on the synchronism effect in 1837 by Turnover. Recall that there was no independent scientific dating method like carbon dating, for instance, back in 1837. Now, the same Ashokan edicts in 20th century, in 21st century, which were assigned dates using methods that have certain methodological issues that we outlined right now, are today used as evidence to corroborate the date of Ashoka and Chandragupta Maurya, thereby setting in place what we see as a circular fallacy. With that, there is a lot more in our paper, but we'll proceed to the next domain, which is archaeology. Now, in Herbert Hartle's essay, the only one in Heinz Bechert's volume focused singularly on archaeology, Hartle concludes, quote, "The scouting through the Buddhist sites has, if a conclusion can be drawn at all, roused doubt in our mind if all the places where the Buddha lived of or which he is said to have visited existed in the 6th century BC, unquote. In this section of our paper, citing archaeological evidence post-1995, we have demonstrated that of Hartle's analysis for 9 sites, the conclusions he reaches for at least 6 are acutely less tenable after 2017. Now, for instance, for Vaishali, Hartle concludes that the earliest habitation was around 500 BC. For Shravasti, he says not older than 6th century BC. For Kaushambi, he says not earlier than 6th century BC. For Rajagriha, he posits at best be pushed down to 500 BC. For Bodhgaya, interestingly, he himself says very old settlement back to Chalcolithic times. And finally, for Lumbini, first settlements did not even reach the 5th century BC, according to Hartle. Now, let's address the first 4 together. Vaishali to Rajagriha. In an article titled No Dark Age in Indian History, Archaeological Evidence, published in 2013, B.R. Mani has included Vaishali, Shravasti, Kaushambi, and Rajagriha in the list of places for which he has concluded thus, quote, "In view of the archaeological evidence from the sites of the Mahajanapadas, it could be authentically concluded that these political principalities and states were well established during the second millennium BCE," unquote. Mani has reinforced this view in a subsequent publication in 2017. All these are detailed in our papers. There's a reference. Seen in light of Mani's statement that I just quoted, Hartle's conclusions for 1 to 4, that is Vaishali, Shravasti, Kaushambi, and Rajagriha, of neither of them showing habitation before 600 BC, are, in our view, an assessment less tenable, acutely less tenable, in 2019 and after. In a paper published in 2013, Mishra and Hazarika, also archaeologists, have shown that the Chalcolithic period was established by 2nd millennium BCE in Bodhgaya, which is the 5th place, which now finally brings us to Lumbini. We went over already what Hartle had said for Lumbini. The first settlements did not even reach the 5th century BC. Now, in a paper titled "The Earliest Buddhist Shrine, Evacuating the Birthplace of the Buddha, Lumbini, Nepal," published in journal Antiquity in 2013, Conyngham et al. Have included thus, quote, radiocarbon samples from two contemporary post-hole fills, parenthesis context 553 and 557, provided dates of 799 to 546 BC and 801 to 548 BC, table 1, suggesting an extremely early delineation of sacred space within this locality and pushing the activity at Lumbini far before the reign of Ashoka, unquote. As you might observe from the table which is there on the left side, 799 to 546 BC and 801 to 548 BC are from the column titled Calibrated 95.4% 2 sigma. If one sees C14H BP, which is the third column from the right, one sees much earlier periods as well, going back, in fact, even to the third millennium BC. However, sticking with the author's conclusions and being super conservative, we posit that if Conyngham et al.'s results hold, then 548 BC at least should serve as a fairly conservative terminus antiquum, and also bringing Hartel's view about Lumbini into question in light of the subsequent published evidence. Now, our paper again contains details, but I will now hand it over to Manogna for astronomy part.
Thank you, Megh. There have been attempts on the Indian side in recent history to use astronomy to date the birth and death of Buddha. Pandit Krota Venkatachalam, Tiruvenkatacharya, Swami Sakyananda, Dr. Sain Gupta, Professor Narahari Achar, they've all used astronomical tools to arrive at the chronological epoch of Buddha. To use astronomical markers for computing this milestone, the primary data required consists of any astronomical observations made during the life of Buddha that have been recorded in the canons, along with the coordinates of the places that have played a significant role in Buddha's life to which the observations are linked. Unlike Indian works, for instance, related to the Mahabharata, which see a host of astronomical references, Buddhist works, unfortunately, carry few such markers. Some are found in the Buddhist works Samyutta Nikaya, while Reverend Begandit's two-volume The Life or Legend of Gautama, it's an 1880 work, being the translation of Mala Alankara Vattu, has a few other astronomical markers which can be used for computation. Even in his 1880 work, interestingly, Reverend Begandit acknowledges that the Tibetans, the Mongols, and the Chinese place Buddha's time much earlier to that of the Sinhalese, and that the Europeans prefer the latter date. The marker in Begandit's work have formed the basis for two major analyses by Dr. Swami Kannupillai and by Pandit Krota Venkatachalam. And interestingly, both arrive at different dates that satisfy the same conditions. Astronomical observations during the period of the last months of Buddha's life, as found in the work Samyutta Nikaya, form the primary source for analysis in our paper. Ancient Indian Chronology, published in 1947 by P.C. Sain Gupta, also is based on the same primary source. While we use astronomical techniques in our study as a method of triangulation along with the other disciplines, we also qualify it that one must define clearly the scope and focus of using it as a tool and not use it for wide brush strokes which make claim outside the purview of what we have defined. And keeping that in mind, our approach to using astronomical techniques to studying the year of Parinirvāṇa is set in three major stages. In the first, we identify and define the astronomical events which serve as the constraint set to look for the year of the death of Buddha. In the second stage, we create master data sets of all the years considered as that of the Parinirvāṇa in two ways. First, by searching for the years that match the constraint set defined in the previous stage using Stellarium as the software. And second, using the compilation of years believed to be that of the Parinirvāṇa from across a range of various traditions and sources, including the Indian Puranic, Colonial Indian, Sinhalese, Chinese, Tibetan, and Japanese. We consider 42 such data points in our analysis. In the third stage, we use NASA's 5 millennium solar and lunar eclipse catalogs, as well as Stellarium once more, to apply the constraints from the first stage to the master data sets and narrow down the most viable data points that satisfy the conditions which we have set up. The markers that we have from Buddha's life, from our primary source, are from the time he spent about 3 months of his life at Shravasti before heading towards Kushinagara, where Buddha spent his eventual last days before the Parinirvāṇa. The Deva Samputta Nikaya, Samyutta Nikaya, refers to the occasion when a lunar eclipse and a solar eclipse occurred in succession when Buddha was staying at Shravasti, along with references to Kashyapa and Magha. The sutra contains defining astronomical constraints believed to have taken place 3 months before the death. So along with this, there is identification of Kashyapa with Prajapati and winter solstice, Magha as with the month of the lunar month Magha, ending on a full moon. Then thirdly, the subsequent occurrence of the lunar eclipse, that is, Chandima is engulfed by Rahu, as said in the sutra. Fourthly, the following solar eclipse within a fortnight, that is, Suryo engulfed by Rahu. Along with these constraints, along with these markers which have been extracted from the sutra, we place additional constraints that the requirement of Vaishakha Purnima occur within a period of 90 days from that of the winter solstice. We also require the Vaishakha Purnima to occur before the following vernal equinox, and we require that the lunar eclipse to have occurred at the start of the month and the solar eclipse at the middle, relying on the phrase in the sutra that Kashyapa, Magha, and Chandima and Suryo visited in quick succession. All of the above requirements constitute what we see as the constraint set, and we refer to them in the methods that we will be applying in the next stage. It's important to note at this stage that even Professor Narahari Achar has studied the problem using the same constraints between 1900 and 400 BC, and he has arrived at 14 data points for application of the constraints. Professor Achar has also analyzed the sutra further to narrow down between the two dates of 1807 BC and 1510 BC using planetarium software. He further studied the positions of the eclipses relative to the interpretations he has made from the sutra and arrived at 1807 BC as the year of Buddha's Parinirvana. While Professor Achar also uses the same constraint, on our end, we have chosen to add an additional constraint that requires the lunar eclipse to have occurred at the start of the month and solar eclipse at the middle, giving weight to the phrase in the sutra that, you know, all Kashyapa, Magha, Chandima, and Suryo visited in quick succession. So that is the differentiator point. Now, in the first method, in our paper, we've looked for the sequence of the above-defined astronomical events, that is, consisting of the winter solstice, the lunar eclipse, solar eclipse occurring in the month of Magha, followed by the full moon of the Parinirvana during the entire period between 1900 to 300 BCE, visible from Shravasti. We have done this using two ways. One is Stellarium, and second is NASA's compilation of the solar and lunar eclipses. Having done so, we have arrived at 16 data points. A detailed study of each data point has included analysis of the nature of the eclipse, the lunar phases, the application of the constraint to each, which we defined earlier, and in the process, eliminate those which don't meet these above-defined criteria. The most viable year of Parinirvana, of Gautama Buddha, which has emerged from this process of elimination, is 1807 BC. In the second method, we have compiled the dates proposed by various schools of thought and people across the spectrum for Buddha's Parinirvana. This is included those from Pandits Kota Venkatachalam, V.G. Ramachandran, D.S. Triveda, then the traditional Chinese and bamboo annals, tantric texts, Theravada Buddhist-based sources, and so on. A comprehensive compilation of 42 points, and subjected each of those to the same astronomical methods which we defined earlier. Now, using these and by applying the constraint set and so on, the most viable year for the Parinirvāṇa, again, which emerges from a process of elimination, is 1807 BC. The full tables of each of these data points are available in our paper on our academia profile. And in the table, if the blue highlights, for instance, they are all indicative of the candidates which were chosen for analysis after applying the constraints and so on. All of these are available in the paper. While we attest to the methodological soundness of our approach in using astronomy at arriving at chronological epochs, some important observations we wish to highlight are regarding the limited set of astronomical references from Buddhist literature that the current study is based on. Further, study would include widening the horizon to include auxiliary sources of references as well. The Samyutta Nikaya has been but one source. Other possible wellsprings include the study of texts and material that have spread along with the Buddhist teachings across Asia. Unearthing of astronomical markers in texts from these regions would be invaluable to further study, for they would lead to expansion of both the data and the constraint sets. We are open to possible change in our conclusions with this potential expansion. We also acknowledge that the analysis of any additional data points which are not currently a part of our data set can subject our current conclusions to a further review. But based on the current sample sizes that we have, the 1807 is the most likely candidate, and we have also showed the stellarium charts for some of these eclipses. I now ask Megh to walk us through the conclusions of all the three sections of the Parinirvāṇa.
Thank you, Manogna. So, we saw philology, archaeology, and astronomy. Now, in philology, if Deitz's essay is the most exhaustive treatment of dates of Buddha's Parinirvāṇa, our examination reveals serious problematics that evidence, as demonstrated, selection bias, hasty generalization, confirmation bias, followed by circular reason. While Bechert dismisses long corrected and short chronology, his own proposal still underpinned by the questionable synchronism. In archaeology, if Hartel's essay is academically the most comprehensive, significant archaeological assessment pertaining to the date of Buddha, for his essay to be seen as corroborations for results from other methods would not be robust anymore, given the new evidence that we have shown after 1995. If Conyngham et al.'s results are robust, 546 BC marks for us authors a terminus antiquum for Buddha's Parinirvāṇa until more robust findings emerge. At the same time, remember that you saw much greater ranges, but we are being conservative. Finally, on astronomy, if the interpretation given to the astronomical markers found in Buddhist texts, Samyukta Nikaya, holds, then the use of stellarium and eclipse catalogues shows 1807 BC as most viable candidate for the year of Parinirvāṇa. The authors also subject the year believed to be that of Parinirvāṇa across a range of traditions and voices to the same constraints, and 1807 BC emerges as the most probable year of the Parinirvāṇa of Gautama Buddha. Over to you, Manogna, for acknowledgements.
Megh and I gratefully acknowledge the work of several people who have had an impact on our work, and the names on this screen don't comprise an exhaustive list. We are thankful to the team at Sangam as well for giving us this platform to present some of our work. Thank you all for joining us today, and we'll be happy to take any questions pertaining to this particular presentation.
Correct. And the acknowledgements, as Manogna said, is limited only to the Buddha paper, right? There are a lot of other scholars' works for Aryan problem, for instance, from Conrad Elst, who I believe is part of the session, and other scholars like Danino, a lot of people, we couldn't include all those names, but this is just a partial list for this particular paper.
Jia, this was a very interesting presentation. I like the empirical approach. I just had a question about, I would say importance of the Aryan invasion theory in discounting a lot of preset notions that we have been force-fed through academia, I guess, within the Indian academic system. And if genetics has been used, or you're considering that as a tool to disprove it, because if you look at the genetic, I think there was a project, global project about human migration, it effectively disproved the Aryan invasion theory. So I was wondering how much Aryan invasion theory weighed down some of the postulates that you made, or if that was a factor at all, and if for your future research you would probably lean on the genetic admixing and whatever information is available so far.
Mohit, while this is not specific to the Buddha, we'll make an exception and take it because it is relevant to our framework on the Aryan problem, right? And it's not talking about anybody else's work. So we'll address this question. So in our paper, we guide you to our Academia Profile Bharatiya Chronology. Find two things over there. One is our 2017 paper. It'll start with the A of ABC of Indian Chronology. Actually, find three things. Second is there's a presentation called Aryan the Problem from the Point of View of Linguistics and Textual Evidence, which was in 2019. More importantly, the third one, our response to the recent genetics, that is then recent, 2019, genetics paper, which came out, and Vagish Narasimhan et al. So the way we look at the whole issue of genetics and the Aryan issue is we are careful about it. And we would like to place ourselves in the school of thought, like, for instance, Michel Danino, who has very carefully articulated the equation that irrespective of what genetics shows in terms of differences in different places, right, in terms of numbers, any conclusion like PIE equal to R1A1, as in directly correlating, let's say, a language group or a language with a particular gene or a gene type, is highly problematic in our view. Now, it does not matter whether you're arguing for an into-India hypothesis or an out-of-India hypothesis. If you are making this link between a gene type and language, I think a lot of care needs to be applied before such linking is made. At the same time, and as we mentioned in our paper, we question the evidence for Aryan migration into India from different fields. And we are careful not to put ourselves in the out of India, as in propagating an out of India position. Though scholars who have propagated out of India positions find some of our work useful to supplement their work. This comes also from the point of view that, since you mentioned the empirical evidence part, right? We don't see an empirical evidence for Proto-Indo-European, for instance, for that construct itself to exist. Now, if Proto-Indo-European can be demonstrated to have existed, comparative historical linguistics as a method, and we refer you to many scholars from linguistics themselves, from, proper comparative linguistics, historical linguistics, who will tell you that absolute chronology information cannot be recovered from comparative methods. I'm wording this carefully. Absolute chronology information cannot be recovered from comparative linguistics method. At best, what you might get is relative chronology, but that itself has in some cases, more exceptions than the norms. So to summarize my answer, specifically on relationship with Aryan migration to genetics, we would put ourselves in the camp of, let's say, Michel Denino, whose 2019 paper very clearly puts out this equation of, you know, connecting a language group to, let's say, a gene type. We'd exercise caution over there. If you want to answer, add anything to that, Manogna, please feel free.
No, I think you've captured it well. And it comes down to recognizing that while genetics as a discipline has its own methods, which it could be very, could perhaps lead to a certain important results, it is careful what assumptions are being brought in as the going in by when using that as a discipline for any analysis of the Aryan situation. I think that is at the heart of it. And one needs to be very careful because that mistake has been repeated in history. And we don't want a different version of wrong assumptions to be the basis of, you know, any theorizations. So I think we choose to tread a bit carefully on that. And I think Megh has articulated it well.
Some remarks from Dr. Konrad Elst. I wonder if he would like to come in and say it himself. He writes, most approaches so far have not been multidisciplinary, so this is a great breakthrough. It ought to force all scholars to be more conscientious henceforth. And he adds, the linguistic part is still weak, but as correctly quoted from linguists themselves, linguistics by itself is powerless to pinpoint a time. And I wonder if Dr. Elst would like to come in and say something. Dr. Elst?
I recall that the speakers and I discussed this evidence already in 2018 in Chennai at Nandita Krishna's conference on the Mahabharata. And I was quite impressed with the results. But you see, 3 years ought to be enough to provoke some serious reactions. Like, for instance, the Tony Joseph book has been quoted all over the place. So, you know, in this case, is there any reaction to be reported? Has this ruffled any feathers, either among the Bechert crowd or among others?
There might be different. Well, thank you, Dr. Elst, for your observations. And yes, we recall meeting you on multiple occasions, of which one you mentioned. To a short answer is no, we don't know if there is any response or if it has any ruffled any feathers. Even with the Aryan thing, for instance, what we did with the National Portal of India, engaging with ICHR and the other ministries after our research, we partly kept it kind of under the radar, you know, in the sense didn't go to town saying that this has happened, this change happened. Because as you rightly pointed out, people like Tony Joseph, and I want to be very respectable over here, as an individual, we don't know him, might be a very good person. We are not commenting on Tony Joseph, the individual, but his view appears to have a lot of dollars backing it, whether it is in form of presence in talks, et cetera, or space in media coverage. Clearly, that's one area where we are disadvantaged. So we are hoping that through an organic process, these things will get picked up and then get amplified. We are not good at that part of it. So we do what we can do, which is just focus on the research part. I hope I have partially answered your question.
So one of the slides that you showed was about the Aryan invasion / migration theory having an implication that Sanskrit, Vedic, all these languages are non-indigenous to India. And you present that as being an adverse consequence. Am I right in my interpretation to start with?
We are saying that an Aryan migration into India, I'm being careful over here, leads to the consequence that the earliest form of Sanskrit and the Vedic literature gets attributed to outside of the Indian subcontinent, at least, certainly. Yeah.
so the thing was that this was only the trailer. So
the
point is that even if it is proven that Sanskrit is actually non-indigenous, or the most ancient form of Sanskrit or Vedic is non-indigenous, how does it really matter? Because Sanskrit or Vedic have undergone their greatest flowering anyway on the Indian subcontinent. This is just like Greek, where, you know, we know that Greek is has intruded at some time, you know, way back before, after the Minoan civilization. Greek is as indigenous to the Grecian islands as any other. And, you know, that literature is celebrated and so on. It's no barrier. That's what I want to tell you. So why is it that we are...
Sorry, I'm losing you a bit. So that's why I answer. Shall I go on? Yes, now I can. I heard your question. I think I got the gist of it. Manogna, add to it after I just add this small bit. Ramakrishnanji, what we agree with parts of what you said, actually, right? There is no need to... You could celebrate the flowering as you put it. And what we would be careful, though, is, for instance, not finding any... We are not being critical of the fact that you compared. But that comparison, first of all, with Greek is not necessary for us. The way we are looking at it is, what was our pursuit is to get to the truth of our civilization, right? Part of our civilization. Now, part of that is our texts, our language, etc., etc. We would be very thankful to anybody, any individual, who can show us one source from before 17th century, from before this loosely Western enterprise to find language families that actually attributes Sanskritam or earliest form of Sanskritam or the Vedas to outside Bharata. Most of the attestation, be it inscriptions, be it texts, other forms, are attested to the Indian subcontinent. So the question for us is not necessarily, why should you be worried? That's a separate thing. What we are asking, what we want to know is the truth. Tell us whether it belongs, is it indigenous to this or not? And if it's not, and if it's established empirically in a sound way, that's fine, in a verifiable way. But there is a whole millennia of evidence of it being indigenous to a particular place in Earth. And then there is few centuries of theorization which tries to relocate it based on certain, you know, constraints which come from a very specific corpus of civilization. I think anybody with a basic scientific outlook can ask the question, why did this change happen? And where does the truth lie? For us, those implications are significant. And if it turns out, like I said, if you can prove it otherwise, then great, no problem. So that's how I would respond to that. Manogna, do you want to add?
I agree. I think that when one sees the nature of this imbalance, when one tradition has put out consistently enough corpus of evidence to show that, you know, the primary language with which it is associated is entirely sustained within its own various parts of flowering, then I think the onus of burden should be, why even entertain this thought that, you know, I mean, that needs to find a heavier justification, right? I mean, there's not sufficient evidence to warrant why. The burden of proof needs to lie with them, not questioning, okay, you know, if it is this, what is the consequence? Right. It may not have much of it, but we see it that way, I think.
Right. And I just add one thing to Manogna, because she mentioned the burden of proof. This is important. For people we have observed over time that when one raises critical observations about Aryan migration into India hypothesis, there is a transfer of burden immediately, where people say, oh, if you're questioning migration, then you need to explain migration into India, then you need to explain out of India theory. As though, if not this, then this. You need to realize that there is a fundamental hypothesis which creates this binary in the first place. That fundamental hypothesis lies in what we see as linguistics, and specifically historical linguistics. That there was a language family. There was one thing from which other things emerged. So if you don't argue this, you have to argue the other thing. We reject this binary. The burden of proof is not on us, according to us, if we are raising questions on Aryan migration. It does not automatically mean that we have to explain out of India theory. If you are propagating Aryan migration into India, the onus is on you to establish it in a way which is verifiable. And because you have a proto-Indo-European construct separately that you want to preserve, that doesn't mean, which by the way is not attested, that doesn't mean therefore the burden is on us to explain the other way around. And also, a migration needn't have happened at one fixed point, 1500 BC, for instance, for languages to have moved. There could have been migrations. Genetics could help us understand that there have been migrations across periods. But this 1500 to 2000 BC, which has a fairly multi-century history and primary linguistics being its carrier, we should remember that historical linguistics as a method does not give absolute chronology, right? So this fusing is something you should be careful of. And in our view, the burden of proof is also another thing that one should be careful of.
Yes, actually, you know, that a pretty interesting point that I missed in my previous question was about the astronomical evidence that you had cited, which has been used to kind of, you know, predate a lot of civilizations, both within medieval Europe and some of the old indigenous American tribes as well. So I think that is a very solid piece of evidence. I'm not sure how validated Stellarium is as a piece of software, but I think that puts a very strong case for your hypothesis. So, you know, how acceptable it is within academia, in your opinion, and, you know, would you advocate using this as a more robust methodology for any future studies of yours?
I think in my view, as I think the method that we have used in this paper for the astronomical analysis is sound. What personally I would like to see more is more data points, right? As much as we have the compilation from across a range of traditional sources, that apart, actual astronomical references from within the text, right, from any across the entire Buddhist canon, which can be studied and then applied, you know, whether it is through Stellarium, whether it is through any other analysis, right? I think seeing an increase in that data set points would be invaluable, in my opinion, to extrapolate this to a much more robust study, right? There's no doubt that we've analyzed 42 points, but that is through a process of elimination. We've eliminated a whole set of data points that don't fit into our method. But what I would like to see are more actual astronomical references. That's why, for instance, when we consider Mahabharata from the Indian canon, at least there is a handful of verses which can be subject to critical examination, which have been subject to critical reading, and, you know, one can extrapolate from them as to what could be. Whereas in this case, I think we are constrained with the verses, and I think that could also be perfectly due to our exposure to it. Maybe we need to also, you know, expand our search, which is a part of our ongoing study. That would, I think, throw up interesting results to expand this entire method to a larger, viewing.
Right. And just to complement Manogna in response to the other facet of the question is, Manogna and I think, are being very careful in judging a discipline, saying, okay, this is the best discipline to take evidence from, or that is the best discipline to take evidence from. Part of the reason for deferring that judgment is because who are we to decide that this discipline is better than the other discipline? The other reason is sometimes the evidence from a certain discipline might give multiple sources if the event is cyclical. For instance, in astronomy, there is potential, I'm not talking about this particular case, but there could be cases where an event is cyclical. It repeats multiple times. So you might not get one, you know, final result. In archaeology, normally you get a range of years. Sometimes a range of years is good enough, right? Sometimes a range of good years is not good enough for a very specific hypothesis. Who is to decide whether archaeology should be considered better than astronomy? In certain cases, it might be. In certain cases, it may not be. How do you validate whether genetics is to be valued over textual sources, if that were to be considered, will Greek history be rewritten based on genetic sources? Because you have the Greek history, which is primarily based on literary evidence. And that is precisely the point that we made in our table where we had the generic format, right? It appears to us that the Indic civilizational narrative is subject to a very high standard of multidisciplinarity. You need to have literary evidence, then archaeology, then geology, then astronomy, then ye sab theek hai, then aur kuch mein problem hai, etc. Whereas if you take, for instance, the historicity of certain Greek figures, right? Are these questions being asked? Are you applying a similar multidisciplinary standard? We are not making a case for that to be applied, but we are simply saying that if in one tradition, it is okay to consider literary sources, still be critical, right? Still be careful, still be logical, etc. But why do our literary sources become some kind of a stigma? So, therefore, we need to, the point that we're trying to make broadly to complement Manogna's clarification on the technical aspect, and Stellarium also, I think, Manogna, you should clarify whether it's a good software or not. But this process of identifying which field is the best solution, I think we take it case by case. Every case, what is the analysis that is there? What is the evidence that is there? See the relative weights and then determine. Of course, there'll be archaeologists who say that is their domain is the best. There might be archaeoastronomers who may say their domain is the best. But we are careful in judging that. And Manogna on the Stellarium.
Yeah, to further augment what you said, I think primarily as a person who uses astronomy, I would say astronomy as a discipline works well only for triangulation purposes. I would be very careful in using that itself as the only discipline to put out assumptions and theories out of which. On the matter of Stellarium, yes, I think Stellarium is a good software for this. I have also used Planetarium earlier, but right now Stellarium has been my main thing. Of course, one can always now with the, if it concerns eclipses, then we can verify it with other catalogs and so on, like the 5 millennium catalogs. At the same time, I think it's also important that for every few hundreds of years that we are going back in time, I think we should also be realistic in assuming what the error margins would be. One should also be realistic in assuming, what is the extent to which one can extrapolate statements. Because it's one thing to, they were all naked observations, right? Naked eye observations to a certain point. At the same time, I think we've been very fortunate with the Indian civilizational situation because it's a phenomenal history of usage of astronomy, right? So that is where I think we're at a big advantage in terms of being able to mine the texts and being able to see such a consistently robust and almost accurate, a good deal of accuracy maintained in the tradition of astronomy itself in the Indian canons. So that is why I think a comparison point like a Mahabharata keeps coming up in my mind, because it may be easier to deal with that than, let's say, something with an auxiliary, portion which emerges. But to come to the main essence of the point, yes, I think Stellarium is a good way of using it, but keeping in mind the constraints that constantly emerge from using it as a tool.
Thank you very much. I noticed a particular slide where you were discussing Bechert's dismissal of the modified long chronology, right? Where one particular thing that stood out was that there were no Indic or local sources from which he draws his conclusions. I think this, I'm not sure, of course you could clarify, this could be possibly because most of the Indic sources have been deemed accretive or unreliable, etc. But probably you could say, say why that is the case. The question though that I have is more generic with respect to this. What I would like to know is that there are a number of foreign sources from which they are depending on evidence, right? So particularly in the case of the Buddha, how does this vary as you move away from the locus of action? I mean, that is northeast, northwest India. How does the dates vary as you go farther away in time? So if we begin from a position of thinking that we don't know the date of the Buddha or where he was from, etc., etc. Sorry, we know where he's from, but we don't know the actual date. How does this vary as, you know, the depending on the change in the antiquity of the text, as well as the distance from the locus of action? So is there some way in which we could, suggest what could qualify as evidence? Because this actually seems to be the norm for Indian historiography, where all sorts of foreign evidence is given precedence over local texts. Thank you. That's my question.
Right. That's fairly the multiple layers to that question. We may not be able to do full justice to the entire question simply because we have not jotted it down. But Rajiv, may I know your background, please, if I may ask?
Thank you very much. I've been interested in this in Indian. Just briefly, I am in my middle age, but the Aryan invasions theory, as it was taught in school, was actually a shock to me because I was brought up learning stories from the Purana. So at one stroke, everything disappeared. It was only much later in the mid-2000s when we followed debates of LSG and, Frawley and Witzel, etc., that we kind of tried, got a better understanding. Thereafter, I did study a bit, basically K.D. Sechna and our Pandit Kota Venkatachalam. But I'm basically an amateur. I used to be an engineer, but right now an entrepreneur, small entrepreneur doing some work. This is my area of interest and okay. I'm deeply passionate about it. Thank you.
Okay, great. So you started off your, thank you for giving us a sense of your background. You started off by making an observation about a statement about Indic texts attestation not being there. That was not part of your question. That was an observation. We will refer you to our entire paper. It might take you 45 minutes to 1.5 hours to read it at normal reading speed. We encourage you to read the entire paper and then come back to us if you have that doubt still in your mind. That's part one. That's not your question. Now, coming to your question, it's an interesting one and something that Manogna and I have discussed, especially when you first considered the distance part, you know, where you were careful to say that we know where he was born, but we don't know what his period was, right? You made loosely that statement. I'm not quoting you back and from what I've noted down. Now, the way Manodna and I are looking at, we'll come to the other parts of your question also, but just a response to that first. The way we are looking at it is, there was some idea or memory of the date of Buddha before 17th century also, before 16th century, 15th century. That is, as we mentioned, Vedvir Arya, who brings in certain sources which are neither European nor Indian and shows how Buddha predates a particular person from that text, which is also another corpus of evidence. So we, our starting point is not necessarily that his period was never remembered. Our starting point was to see, was his period remembered first? If it was remembered, how was it remembered? In what sources? Right? That is when you get the range of sources that are involved, right? So there it becomes interesting. For instance, the Sri Lankan sources, the Ceylonese sources give you this 500 BC in that range, right? So if Buddha was born in a particular place, unless you assume fantastic communication and, you know, transportation in 500 BCs, etc. It would be a little hard to imagine how that nation, for instance, proceeded so quickly to that place, and where you have an entire history all being set up. There are certain questions which one can raise in terms of, you know, the distance and locus. Why is it that the Chinese and the Japanese remember a much earlier period? What is clear is that the European scholars had a clear motivation to reduce that, right, through the synchronism. Because for them, at that point of time, there was the Usher chronology, there was the biblical frame, and this, whether right or wrong, whether valid or not in 21st century, was clearly exceeding their frame. And one handle that they used was Sandrocortes, which K.D. Setnaji has also written about. Sandrocortes is then considered to sound similar to Chandragupta. Now, why Chandragupta Maurya? There is Chandragupta Gupta also, right? If one were to accommodate the phonetic similarity for a moment, we are not saying it is similar, but if you were to accommodate it, there are two Chandraguptas. And we are not the first ones who are making this point. This point is made. Several people, unfortunately, it is not known enough, right? So there could be, there is another Chandragupta. Or is Sandrocortes sounding like Samudragupta, for instance? If you can argue that Sandrocortes sounds like Chandragupta, I would argue, for instance, that Sandrocortes could sound like Samudragupta also, right? So there was a motivation for a particular tradition to fit it into a particular narrative, and therefore the long chronology got corrected to the corrected long chronology, right? But the long chronology itself was only one of the many views that existed at that point of time. And that reduction, in our view, is both hasty, and it also shows a confirmation bias, as we have articulated. With regard to distance from where the person is born, there may or may not be a correlation, but whether we should add weight to that correlation is something that one should evaluate carefully, because these are, I think, external constraints that we are bringing on to the topic at hand, which is, and the topic at hand, for instance, in Greek sources, if you're dealing with this problem, would be very simple. Is there a source, verifiable source? Is it textual? Is it archaeological? Is it something material that you can, you know, pick up? And there has been, as we shown, Troyer's view, which says that he has remembered that the Hindus remembered Chandragupta Maurya in 1502 BC. We're not saying it is absolutely correct, but we are saying there is that memory. Why was that missed out? And that has driven our exploration, our way of shortlisting. I think on your third layer of correlating distance from the place of birth is something that can be undertaken to see if it supports an hypothesis in a particular view. But the initial feeling is one might need to be careful about taking that as a very strong influencing basis to influence the discussion on the date itself. Manogna, do you want to add?
I agree that I think it's a very interesting point to explore further. And the way I see it is that possible potential lines of exploration are linked not only in terms of, let's say, the Buddhist literature which passed on from the geographical area that we associate with Buddha's life to, you know, further, let's say, to the immediate neighborhood of Tibet or China or whatever other geographical spread that we see. I think it would be interesting to see if even along with the Buddhist literature, if there has been any other work which has in any other intellectual material which has been taken along that would have left behind some markers. And there are interesting papers. Bill Mark, for instance, he studies the influence of Indian astronomy on Chinese astronomy, and especially, let's say, which emerge from from influences of Buddhist texts. So there are, I think there are tertiary levels which are there right now. I mean, most of the data that is there could be at the level that one would say tertiary, but it would be actually a very interesting line of work to examine them further and see what is it that emerges. Because even in 1880, when in the book that we've used, Reverend Bajandit, he is openly acknowledging that Tibetans and Munrols and Chinese, which is geographically closest to the region associated with Buddha, acknowledge and much prefer a much earlier time to that of the Sindhis, and the Europeans knew about it. So there is acknowledgement of this, there is an attestation of it, but how that actually maps out with to create a pattern, right? To create a pattern and to derive that as a conclusion, I think it would need a lot more primary and secondary data sources to validate, but it's definitely an interesting point to explore.